This evening, we're returning to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 15 through 20. I'd like to begin by reading that text. Now, this time I will start in verse 15. I hope that doesn't throw anybody off. Okay, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning in verse 15. And again, I would just encourage all of us to listen carefully to what it is that Paul writes here, realizing that these just weren't his thoughts and his ideas of what he thought things were like, but the Spirit of God was speaking through him, telling us things that are true, and they're true of us if we belong to the Lord Jesus. And again, they are glorious truths, but they do call us to a very high responsibility, and the Lord would have us to take those things seriously. Paul writes, beginning in verse 15, "Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take away the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? May it never be. Or do you not know that the one who joins himself to a prostitute is one body with her? For he says the two shall become one flesh. But the one who joins himself to the Lord is one spirit with him. Flee immorality. Every other sin that a man commits is outside the body, but the immoral man sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you have been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body." May the Lord bless again this part of his word to our edification this evening, to our building up in Christ. Now, this morning, just by way of reminder, we were looking at the union that we have with the Lord Jesus. And actually, there are many ways in which we are united with him, but we focused on two in particular: the vital or living union that we have with Jesus by his Holy Spirit, and the legal union that we have with him. Now, we noted that we didn't always have this blessing. We came into this world separate from him, and being separate from him and his life, we didn't have these blessings, and we were spiritually dead. But in his mercy, the Lord sent a messenger to us, one of his people, an ambassador who had the gospel, who shared it with us. And also by his grace, he sent his Spirit to accompany that good news, and made us alive, called us inwardly, united us to the Lord Jesus Christ. The Spirit plugged us into Christ, and once his life began to flow through us, which is the Holy Spirit, once it began to flow through our souls, it changed us. We no longer wanted what we wanted before, which was sin. Now we wanted him. We turned from the direction we were headed, and we trusted him, and we were saved. Now, that is our vital union with Jesus. His life is now within us. The Spirit has united us to Jesus. But there's another sense in which we are united to him, and that is legally. Now, as I mentioned this morning, this kind of union is pictured in many different ways in the Bible, actually union with Jesus in general. It is represented as adoption. God becomes our Father, and we become his children. And as children, we have the rights of the children of God. All the blessings that he has, he gives to us. In that adoption, Jesus becomes our brother, and we become then heirs with him. This union is represented, as we saw this morning, as a marriage. Jesus, as our husband, takes us to be his bride. And of course, now that we are united with him in this covenant of marriage, which is essentially the new covenant, he gives to us all that he possesses, and all that we have becomes his. He represents it as a temple. We are like so many living stones being built together into a spiritual dwelling in which he inhabits. And then one we're going to focus on particularly this evening, that union is represented as a body. His Spirit baptizes us into him. We become his members, the parts of his body, his mystical body, his spiritual body, and he becomes our head. Now, we saw this morning his Spirit, who joins us to Jesus in this vital union, who puts us in Jesus in this covenant, making us, again, legally able to receive everything that it is that he has earned for us. The Spirit himself is actually the glue of that union with the Lord Jesus. And that union is going to hold us together for the rest of time. This is an eternal covenant. Remember, we saw this morning, or at least noted, that God has had this in his mind and in his heart throughout all eternity. And it's not something that is going to change. He is simply, as it were, doing in time what he has purposed in eternity. And that is something he will carry out for the rest of time. So having been joined to Christ by the Holy Spirit, that union is going to hold forever. Now this evening, what I would like us to do is consider how this union is to work itself out in our lives. Now we saw this morning that it means that we do share in the things that Jesus has actually earned for us, he has gained for us through his work of salvation. Really, every blessing that we have comes to us through this covenant. It comes through the work of Jesus. It comes through the things that were promised to him by his Father for this work. But this union also has implications that maybe we don't think about as often as we should, at least not in these particular terms that we're going to look at this evening. Now, it means that as we possess what belongs to him, as we receive all the blessings that he has, he also possesses what belongs to us. Everything that belongs to us really belongs to him. But we want to focus particularly this evening on the fact that our bodies and our souls belong to the Lord. That's what Paul is focusing on in our text. He tells us that our souls have been united to him by his Holy Spirit. Again, Paul writes in our passage in 1 Corinthians 6, verse 17, but the one who joins himself, the one who is glued to the Lord, glued together with him by the Holy Spirit, is one spirit with him. And again, even though the text is translated with a lowercase s for spirit, it should be uppercase. We are joined to the Lord by his Holy Spirit. We are one spirit with him. This is exactly what Peter was referring to when he says in 2 Peter 1:4, for by these, and by these he's referring to his gospel and his Spirit, he, that is the Lord Jesus, has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises, so that by them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world by lust. Now, Peter, when he talks about the divine nature here, is not talking about what some of the more prominent charismatic, full gospel, Pentecostal type preachers are saying, that somehow we become gods, little gods, share the same nature as God in the sense that we somehow are elevated to his status of being. But what he means is that we become partakers of the Holy Spirit, who is the one who unites us to Jesus and is working that same image of Jesus within us, that divine moral nature, not the transcendent essence and substance of God. We are not elevated to godhood, but we do share those things that we can share in the Lord, what we call his communicable attributes. We become like him morally. Now, our bodies are also united to him. Paul writes in verse 15 of 1 Corinthians 6, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? And then he says in verse 19, or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? Paul says that our bodies are his temples. Peter tells us that they're like so many living stones in the larger temple, which is the mystical body of Christ, which is his church, and that our bodies are members of his spiritual body. Now, as a result of this union of our souls with the Spirit of God and our bodies with the Lord Jesus Christ, he says, we no longer belong to ourselves. We have been purchased, we have been bought, and that at an infinite cost, the cost of Jesus' own precious life. And so we are to give ourselves to him. We are to use our lives, everything we possess, all the faculties of our souls, which would include, of course, our intelligence, our minds, our wills, our affections, whatever spiritual gifts that he has given to us, I think we would include that in the faculties of our souls. And we are to use our bodies, love him with all of our strength, and of course, serve him, and use even the faculty of speech for his purposes. Again, Paul writes in verse 20 of 1 Corinthians 6, "For you have been bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body." That is what the Lord would have us to do. And it's the same thing that Paul is referring to in Romans 12, verse 1, when he says this, "Therefore I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, in light of what he has done for you, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship." Now, we often talk about how should we worship God, and when we think about that, we usually think of just the context of this worship service. But notice Paul says our spiritual service of worship is much broader than what we do during this service. What the Lord desires from us is that we present our bodies continually before him, as not to kill ourselves and, as it were, and to be burned upon his altar, but to be a living and holy sacrifice. We give up what we used to pursue in order to pursue what the Lord would have us to pursue. Now, this means at least two things. It means, first of all, that we are no longer to live for sin, but we are to allow him to use us in any way that he desires to serve him. Now, this was the point that Ferguson brought up. We are not to use our members. We are not to use our bodies any longer for sin. And he gave us a very important reason, which is one that we don't often hear, and that is because we belong to Jesus, because we are his members, because we're united to him, because he lives in us, when we sin, we are actually involving Jesus in that sin. Now, Paul actually brings that out in our text in what we might consider a pretty shocking example in verses 15 and 16. He says, "Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take away the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? May it never be. Or do you not know that the one who joins himself to a prostitute is one body with her? For he says, the two shall become one flesh." Now, Paul may not spell it out completely here, but I believe the implication of what he's saying is clear. To join what belongs to Jesus Christ to a prostitute is, in some sense, to join Christ to that prostitute. Sinclair Ferguson noted that to be a Christian and to enter a place where prostitutes would be, a brothel, is to take Christ into that brothel with you. And I think we've heard that before. Jesus is with us. We take him wherever we go. And we need to be careful where we go because Jesus is with us. But again, it's a little more intimate than that. Jesus, again, is with us, yes. But we belong to him and we are involving him. He's not just a bystander. We're taking what belongs to him and we're using it for sin if we do things that he doesn't want us to do. Every time we sin, Jesus is involved. Now, that is one of the reasons why Paul tells us that we are not to sin. And again, why he said in our text this morning in Romans chapter 6, that having died to sin with the Lord Jesus Christ, remember, we're in union with him. When he died on the cross, we died with him. When he was raised, we were raised with him. We are now to live for his glory, and that is because he is involved in what we're doing. we are in union with him. Paul writes in Romans 6, verses 8 through 13. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, is never to die again. Death no longer is master over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its lusts. And do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. We've died with him, we've been raised with him, died to sin, now to live to righteousness. We are united to Jesus Christ. We are involving him in the things that we do. Can you think of a better reason why we should not disobey God? Now, we shouldn't do it because, as our Lord, Jesus tells us not to sin. And he tells us not to sin because it's dishonoring to him, but it's also harmful to us and it's harmful to others. It is an act of hatred, really, towards all the parties involved. We shouldn't sin because he has given us his Holy Spirit, who is working within us to give us the desire to do what is right, not to sin, and the power not to sin. The Spirit of God has broken that bondage, and he's given us the desire to do what's right, and we should not sin on account of that. We shouldn't sin because we love Jesus, and we want to do what is pleasing to him. All of those things are true. But now we see that because of our union with him, every time we sin, we are involving him in that sin. And I think perhaps this should be the greatest reason of all. Do we want to take what belongs to Jesus and use it for things we know are dishonoring? So think about, let's take a moment and think about our lives. Do we want to take Jesus everywhere that we go? Do we want Jesus to be involved in everything that we're doing? Do we want him to be caught up and to know, I mean, basically be involved in what we're thinking and what we're speaking? You see, if we don't want to include him in certain things in our lives, those are the things that we need to give up. We need to turn from them and not involve him in these things, not subject him to these things. Instead, we need to do what pleases him. So the first consequence of this union is, remember that we're involving Jesus in the things that we do. So we need to be careful what we do. Now, rather than involve him in sin, we should involve him in the things that he desires for us to be doing. We should use our souls and our bodies to glorify him. Now again, this is why he saved us. This is why he gave us his Holy Spirit. This is why he united himself to us, is so that we might be his instruments through which he will do his work. Now this, I think, is the main point that we want to see this evening. It's been said that the book, The Acts of the Apostles, has really a bad title, or at least a misleading title. It should be called The Continuing Acts of Jesus Christ, because he is the one who was doing the work his apostles were doing through his Holy Spirit. Jesus was working through them in order to advance his kingdom. Now, Paul, this is how he viewed his own experience with regard to his own life and the Lord working through him. This morning we read Galatians 2:20 as our meditation. And what Paul says of himself here is also true of us, remember. He says, I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. Now, a couple of things to note here. First of all, Paul recognizes his union with Jesus Christ, which means that when Jesus died, he died with him, he was crucified with him. He recognizes that having died with Christ and having been raised to Christ and in union with Christ, it's no longer he. No, he's no longer the one who is alive, but Christ is living in him. But he also recognizes one further thing, and that is that even though that's true, he still exists. I mean, his personality is still there. And there are still choices that he's making that he needs to make. So he says, the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. And in that statement, he's basically summarizing that he is doing all that Jesus is calling him to do. He is living by the word of Christ, submitting to his will, doing what it is he wants. Now, I think perhaps the best analogy that Paul gives to us of the purpose behind our union with the Lord Jesus, why it is that Jesus united us to himself, is when he describes the church as a body with Jesus as its head. Remember, the Spirit is the one who joins us to Christ. Paul says he is the one who actually unites us to Jesus and baptizes us into Christ. And when he does that, we become a part of his body. 1 Corinthians 12, verses 12 through 13. For even as the body is one, and yet has many members, and all the members of the body, though they are many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Now, this not only tells us that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is something that all Christians experience, and it not only tells us that that baptism is not something that necessarily has various signs connected to it, as we often hear. You need to be baptized by the Spirit and exhibit various spiritual gifts. But it tells us that the purpose behind that baptism was to place us within the body of Christ. There's only one body. It's not a body of Gentiles and a body of Jews, but we are all one in the Lord Jesus. He has only one body. When he places us in this body, it is only this particular one. Now, he also goes on to tell us that Christ, of course, is the head of that body. He writes to the Ephesians, what we read this morning in Ephesians 5:23, for the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ also is the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. And he writes to the believers at Colossae, in Colossians 1:18, he is also the head of the body, the church. And he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have first place in everything. Now, the point of this analogy, of this illustration, is to show us that as the head, Jesus controls the body. Our heads are basically the control center for our bodies, and they tell our bodies what to do. We're able to accomplish what we want through our bodies. So basically, the head is the control center, and the body are the instruments through which we accomplish what it is that we want, as it were, from our heads, what we desire. Well, in the same way, Jesus is our head, who is working through us, the members of his body, in order to carry out what it is that he desires. We are his legs, we are his arms, we are his hands. If he is going to provide certain kinds of service to this world, the way he's going to do it is through us, because we are his members. We are also his mouth. If he's going to bring his gospel, if he's going to communicate his gospel to the people in this world, if it's going to be communicated to our family and our friends and our neighbors that we prayed for earlier, he's going to do it through us. Not through the angels, but he's going to do it through us. Now, Jesus wants to work through us. That's the whole purpose of this union. And he wants to do it in three different areas, basically the same three areas that Jesus was laboring in as he when he was in this world. He wants to work through us to glorify his Father. He wants to work through us to serve his brethren, to serve one another. And he wants to work through us to reach the lost. When Jesus was on earth, his main objective, I think there's no question about this, was to honor the Father, to bring glory to him. Jesus said to his disciples in John 4, verse 34, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work." And remember, he said that in the context of his disciples bringing food to him because they knew he was hungry, they knew he was weary by the well, and so forth. But when they brought it to him, he said, "It was more important to me to glorify my Father than it is to take care of the needs of my physical body." He wants us to do the same thing. He wants to do the same thing through us. Paul again reminds us in our text in 1 Corinthians 6:20, "For you have been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body." Now, we could actually stop here and spend a great deal of time talking about exactly how we do that. We're not going to do that this evening, but let me just mention a couple of things. First of all, Jesus did this in his private worship, in his public worship. Certainly, that's what the Spirit of God is doing through us. Jesus is using us, even now, to give glory to his Father. He is working through us, using his members to honor him. So we need to bear that in mind every time we come to worship. The Lord is using us and wants to use us to glorify his Father. But there's two other main areas in which Jesus glorified his Father, and those are the other two that Jesus did while he was in the world: serving his brethren, reaching out to his neighbors. Now again, we could spend a lot of time on this, but let me just say a couple of things. Jesus served his brethren by laying down his life for them. And that's what he wants us to do for each other. Jesus said in the Good Shepherd Discourse, which is John chapter 10, in verses 14 and 15, "I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me, even as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." And then Jesus, in that same gospel, says to his disciples, in what's called the Upper Room Discourse in chapters 13 through 16, and actually Sinclair Ferguson has a good series on that as well. He says in John 15, verses 12 and 13, "This is my commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends." Jesus says, "I'm the good shepherd. I lay down my life for the sheep. I lay down my life for you," Jesus says to his disciples. And then he says to his disciples, "I want you to do the same thing." And that doesn't just mean die for your brother or sister. If the Lord calls you to die for them in the sense of giving up your life, but it means that in every other sense as well, we lay down our lives in order to serve one another, to take care of one another, to love one another. Another way of putting it is, as Paul describes it, the body of Christ, when one member suffers, we all suffer with it. When one member rejoices, we all rejoice with it. And, you know, we know how that works. If you stub your toe, the whole of your attention goes to that toe. And if for some reason you're enjoying, let's say, a good meal, your whole body rejoices with the taste that's, you know, that you're experiencing, that pleasure. So the same thing in the body of Christ. If one member is suffering, we should be thinking about that person and seeking to help them and to minister to them, even as we would one of the members of our body if it was injured. If one is rejoicing, then let's rejoice with them. Laying down our lives for one another, Jesus wants to do that through us. He wants to use us as his members to minister to the other members of his body. And then, of course, Jesus served his neighbor. And he did that by reaching out to them with the gospel in order to save them. Here's one example in Luke 19, verses 1 through 10, the example of Zacchaeus. Luke records, "He entered Jericho and was passing through. There was a man called by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and he was rich. Zacchaeus was trying to see who Jesus was and was unable because of the crowd, for he was small in stature. So he ran on ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree in order to see him, for he was about to pass through that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for today I must stay at your house." And he hurried and came down and received him gladly. When they saw it, they all began to grumble, saying, "He has gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stopped and said to the Lord, "Behold, Lord, half of my possessions I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will give back four times as much." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost." Why did Jesus stop and look up at Zacchaeus and tell him to come down? Why did Jesus go to Zacchaeus' house? Why did he reach out to him? He was seeking to save him. And the Lord obviously wants to work through us as well to reach out to the lost in order that they might be saved. How are they going to hear unless somebody who knows the gospel tells them? We are the mouth of the Lord, and he wants us to speak to them. Now, Jesus' work did not come to an end when he died on the cross. It didn't come to an end when he rose and when he ascended. We know Jesus is actively working, even now in heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us and ruling and governing, essentially, the entire creation. But his work on earth, that more personal work, didn't end when Jesus ascended. It didn't end when the book of Acts concluded, when that portion of history was over. The Lord has continued that work from that time until the present through all the members of his body. Today, he wants to continue it through us. And so let's be encouraged this evening to make sure that we are allowing him to do that, to use our lives as he wants. Remember, he lives in us. He wants to do this work. We no longer live. Christ lives in us. But there's still the I that can either yield to what the Lord wants us to do or resist what the Lord wants us to do. We need to live by faith in the Son of God who loved us and gave himself up for us. Don't make Jesus participate in things that you know he doesn't approve of. But instead, give yourself to the things you know he wants you to do. Well, may the Lord help all of us to do that. Let's spend a few moments in silent prayer, and let's pray that he will help us.